Good afternoon, everyone. Warm welcome to this public seminar organized by the Center for Financial Econometrics at the Singapore Institute for Financial Economics. Some of you may know that the Singapore Institute for Financial Economics, also known as SKBI, was established 3 years ago jointly by MAS and SMU to promote studies of financial economics and financial econometrics in areas that are strategically relevant to Singapore economy and the economies of the region. We have four centers under the SKBI. One of them is today's event organizer, the Center for Financial Econometrics. The Center for Financial Econometrics, although only started in 2008, 3 years ago, we are quite proud of the achievement of the center. This center has produced many publications in leading academic journals over the last couple of years that helped SMU to rank number 5 worldwide for research in econometrics. This ranking was done by a European university very recently. And we know that today we are living in a very dynamic world. Some of you may know that Harry Markowitz invented portfolio optimization in his Ph.D. thesis at the University of Chicago in the early 50s. I've told my student, never underestimate yourself when you're doing a Ph.D. At that time, the topic was very, very novel, very new, so that when he was defending his Ph.D. thesis, Milton Friedman argued that his contribution is not economics. So he nearly failed to get his Ph.D. degree. And of course, history proved that Friedman is not correct. And today we know that Markowitz's theory has been taught in almost all business schools for generations, and is widely used in practice. And the Markowitz name is equivalent to modern portfolio theory. However, it's very hard to believe that a simple theory works for 60 years, especially given that we have seen so many financial crises, including a very drastic one we are still going through. The financial crisis certainly put many basic theory in financial economics in doubt. So today is my honor to introduce a leading expert on this exact topic to you, Dr. Paul Kaplan from Morningstar Europe. Dr. Kaplan is a quantitative research director at Morningstar Europe. He is responsible for quantitative research behind the company's fund analysis, indices, and advisory tools. Dr. Kaplan has been in the editorial board of the Financial Analysis Journal. That's a leading professional practitioner journal in the profession of financial economics. Since 2011, he has been in the advisory board of the Center for Asset Management Research at Cass Business School in UK. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me to welcome Dr. Kaplan.
After Milton Friedman said this is not economics, we cannot give you a PhD in economics, another member of Harry Markowitz's committee said this is not mathematics, we cannot give you a PhD in mathematics. And then finally, the third one said this is not English, we cannot give you a PhD in English. At that point, Harry Markowitz was asked to leave the room. And then moments later, Milton Friedman put his head out the door and said, "Congratulations, Dr. Markowitz." So you see, Milton Friedman did come around fairly quickly to understanding that Harry Markowitz's contribution, and actually we can really divide the history of investment theory before 1952 and after 1952. This was the watershed moment in our profession, and it is the standard approach that is globally used and was recognized by the Nobel Prize Committee when Harry Markowitz and two other economists, financial economists, were awarded the Nobel Prize. And back in 1952, when Harry Markowitz wrote his very first article on the topic, he said, in our analyses, the portfolio weights might represent individual securities, or they might represent aggregates such as, say, bonds, stocks, and real estate. So right from the beginning, Markowitz already had asset allocation in mind as an application of his theory. I interviewed Harry Markowitz a few years ago, and this is one thing he had to say. I think the most important thing that happened in 1959, that's the year he published a full book on the topic of portfolio selection, and I will from time to time this afternoon mention some of the ideas in that book. And the present is the notion of doing your asset analysis on asset classes in the first instance. This has become part of the infrastructure that we now rely on. I had a rationale and so on. Now we have an industry. So quite a span from a pure mathematical theory to really standard practice. And the idea of asset allocation, as I cited Markowitz in the quote, was in the first instance to do asset allocation. Break down your portfolio between the basic asset classes, so for example, equities, fixed income, and real estate, and you could add, you know, other asset classes as well, and then implement your asset classes with various managers. These could be active managers, index funds, exchange-traded funds, and so on. So how to do asset allocation? Well, this is, of course, has always been a great subject of debate. Some people have argued 1/N. Naive method. If you have 4 asset classes, put 25% in each. If you have 5 asset classes, put 20% in each. The second approach was popularized by William Sharp, who also did his Ph.D. at the University of Chicago, and Harry Markowitz was an informal advisor to him. Sharp developed, of course, famously the capital asset pricing model, and Sharp was also one of the winners of the Nobel Prize jointly with Harry Markowitz and also Miller. So that's the second approach, which basically says hold the market. And hold the market in proportion to market capitalization, which of course has most widely been applied to the concept of indexes and index funds. And today we have a very large and growing industry in index funds, and most recently in exchange-traded funds, or ETFs. The third approach was really going back to what Markowitz said in the first place, which was to use an optimization algorithm to develop your asset mix. Said that back in 1952, as I just showed you. And then the second approach, which I'm going to talk about today, is what Sam Savage, who teaches at Stanford University, and I have dubbed Markowitz 2.0. If you were going to use the CAPM approach, you need to know what the world market portfolio looks like. So here's what it looked like back in summer of 2010. Obviously you can see quite a bit of equities and actually bonds being actually larger than equities, and of course the U.S. Playing a very large part of the market, but also a lot of non-U.S. market, emerging market equity, up to over 4% of the world. This of course is only an estimate, simply based upon the best data we had when we put this slide together. So if you were a CAPM investor, you would hold this portfolio. If you wanted to take less risk than the market, you would hold this portfolio in combination with cash. If you wanted to hold more risk in this market than this portfolio, you would borrow money and then take a leverage position in the world market portfolio. That's the cap down. Now, going back then to Harry Markowitz's mean variance optimization, the way we do that is for each asset class, we come up with an expected return, a standard deviation, and then for each pair of asset classes, a correlation coefficient. We put that into the mean variance optimization software, and out pops an efficient frontier. And of course, one of the lessons of asset allocation is that the more asset classes, the better, because we can get more diversification benefits, and that we can exhibit that through the efficient frontier. The higher and more to the left the efficient frontier is, the better. And the way we achieve that, as this chart shows, is by adding more and more, more undiversified asset classes. And of course, that's the key. The asset classes have to be at least somewhat uncorrelated, not totally correlated, some certain degree of lack of correlation. Okay, there we go. So I summarized this, my opening remarks, with just to remind people what are the principles of asset allocation. Diversification across asset classes, of course, is number one. Once you've done that, the second step is to implement, and you can use low-cost index funds, including ETFs, to do that. You can also use fund research and try to find superior active managers. The third point, which is probably the most difficult, one of the most difficult points, at least for individual investors, is to rebalance regularly. Why? Because in order to maintain any given asset mix, you have to, from time to time, sell off the asset class in which you made money and buy into the asset class in which you might have lost money. It's a very difficult thing psychologically for people to sell off their winners and buy their losers, but that's exactly what we tell them to do. Whether they do it or not is another question. And then the fourth point is be patient and stay in for the long run. Asset allocation, or at least strategic asset allocation, as this is sometimes called, is really a very long-term thing. You basically are in it for your investment life. You buy and you diversify across asset classes. You rebalance regularly. You do this consistently, and you have to be willing to go through the hard times as well as the good, which is really what I'm going to talk about more next. This chart is a very well-known chart. It was originally developed by Roger Ibbotson's firm, Ibbotson Associates. What it is, it's called SBBI, Stocks, Bonds, Bills, and Inflation. This is the Morningstar currently produces this chart. This is what it was through 2009. It goes back to 1926. That's because that's when the Center for Research of Security Prices, or CRISP, at the University of Chicago started their database. And then you have the crash of 1929. And then you have a very long period of depressed equity prices. This is with total return, so it still includes the dividends. And what you can see, however, is that over the long run, even though we had the crash of 1929, the crash of the 70s, the crash of 1987, the crash of 2000, and then the recent crash of 2008, which you can see at the very end of the chart, a stock investor who was patient would have done very well. One U.S. dollar over this period would have grown over 2,500 times its value, which is a pretty good deal considering by inflation the value of the dollar, the value of the U.S. dollar against goods and services, as measured by the CPI, basically lost value by a factor of 12. Now, if you held bonds, if you were very risk averse, you'd say, well, I would have held bonds over the period. Your dollar would have only grown to $84 and cash only to $21. So you can see quite a remarkable difference to the way equity and fixed income has behaved over the long run, at least in the U.S. But you say, well, the equity market is very risky. I don't want all that risk of the equity market. That's where asset allocation comes in, and we can blend stocks and bonds. And of course, we're not going to make nearly as much money as we would in the stock market alone, but we're going to make a lot more than we would in the bond market. And in the process, we're going to lower the volatility. What about in 2008? We heard a lot of people saying asset allocation didn't work. What happened in 2008 was that the global equity markets all came crashing down together. But what did people do with their money? You know, well, the money they still had left. They put it in high quality sovereigns, is what they did. And you know, in this case, particularly the US Treasury bonds. So actually, while stocks were losing money, bonds actually did pretty well. And if you had practiced asset allocation, you would have come out a lot better than had you been in 100% equities. So diversification does work during market crises, but you really do have to be sure you are well diversified across a variety of asset classes and not think you're diversified simply because you have different types of equity. Okay, obviously the crash of 2008, the global financial crisis, was considered a very unusual event, a low probability event, and some people have described it as a black swan, which is a concept that has been popularized by Nissim Taleb, particularly in the title of this book called The Black Swan. And what is a black swan? What is it? In order for something to be a black swan, it has to be inconsistent with the past. It has to be something that was really totally unpredictable, never seen before. Is that what the market crash of 2008 was? I don't think so. This is what I think it was. The black turkey. Not a black swan. What's a black turkey? This is defined in an article by Larry Siegel, who's the director of research at the CFA Institute. An event that is everywhere in the data, it happens all the time, but to which one is willfully blind. We live in an amazingly myopic industry. We simply forget the past. So of course, if we go back over the past century, of course we're going to find plenty of market crashes. U.S. equities, of course, and of course the worst one of all was in 1929. But even bonds lost money over a 40, not in a crash, but over a 40-year period because of unexpected inflation in the U.S. The U.K. is an interesting one because the U.K. market lost 3/4 of its value in the early 70s. So when I give this presentation in the UK and I ask the audience, who remembers the crash of the 70s? Hands do go up, if there are people old enough in the audience. If you think 1929 was too long ago, how about the 70s? Was that too long ago? Gold, which of course is what people flee to, also, in when markets are down, also lost 62% of its value in the early 80s. So that doesn't always work. And of course, I'm sure here you're very familiar with the very sad story of the Japanese equity market since 1990, 22 years now. Okay. So the fact that we know that there really are black turkeys in the data tells us that there really are fat tail events. And one of the limitations of the original Markowitz model is that you couldn't really model fat tails. There's mean invariance. There was also the assumption that covariation could be modeled by a single number, the correlation coefficient. And I'm going to challenge that assumption in a few minutes. There's also the question of what is the investment horizon when you do mean variance analysis? It's only one period, but investors, of course, invest over the long run. Risk is measured by volatility. This is probably what's received the most criticism. Standard deviation is not really a measure of risk. It's really a measure of how volatile returns are. And that we really need, and especially when there are fat tails, we really need to focus on tail risk. I'm going to talk more about that. If we use a bell curve to model monthly returns going back to 1926, this is what it looks like. And in particular, this is what the tail, left tail looks like. The green line is the bell curve. The blue bars are the actual data, and you can see they just don't match at all. Because if things follow the bell curve, then we know that only 1 in 1,000 times should you get an event that's more than 3 standard deviations away. But historically, over this 1,000-month period, there were actually 10 months in which that occurred. So clearly, the bell curve severely underestimates the tail. And actually, it underestimates the right tail as well, but I'm focusing on the left tail today. Global equities, again, you can see how the bell curve misses out on modeling the left tail. It also misses out on the right tail, too. This is what I was saying about the weakness of correlation. This is US stocks versus non-US stocks monthly data going back to 1970. And what you'll note, if correlation were a good model, then I should be able to draw a straight line through the chart and have half the points above the line and half the points below the line. That's true until you get to negative 10%. And what happens to the left of negative 10%, whenever the US stock market lost 10% or more, so did the world stock market. There are no dots above the straight line. What I did here to try to fix that was bend the line. I'm trying to emphasize here, it's not a linear relationship. It's not a simple correlation relationship. We need to do better than that. Now, as far as return distributions, here what I'm going to do is borrow an idea from Talib, which is where I first heard of this idea. Tame versus wild randomness. So I think the best way to illustrate this is simply imagine picking 1,000 people at random, filling an auditorium, and then not knowing anything about the people, estimate what the average weight is. So you might say, okay, well, people are on average about 70 kilos. So 70 kilos would be my estimate. Now a sumo wrestler enters the auditorium. What happens to the average? Goes up, but by how much? Very little. Human weight follows a bell curve. It is randomly distributed across the population, but sumo wrestlers are very rare. And even sumo wrestlers are only so many standard deviations away from the mean. So it works. Wealth. Now let's survey the wealth of the people in the room. You come up with some number of how wealthy they might be. And then Warren Buffett enters the auditorium. What happens to your average? Goes way off, right? Way, okay. So we have here is one single outlier totally changing the average, or one single event, or this is, you might say Warren Buffett entering the room is kind of a fat tail. So here's the question, and this has been debated very hotly. Do return distributions follow, are they like weight, or are they like wealth? Now I believe they're like wealth. I believe that when you look at the data, you see all these black turkey events, you see all these extremes. And yet, for some reason, we've built our whole science on the idea that they basically follow, they're like weight. And we often use bell curve models or models that are similar to bell curves, and we don't take into account the fat tails. Now, there are ways, in fact, in statistics of taking into account fat tails. Here are four distributions. The bell curve is the log normal here. The Johnson is a generalization of that, which allows us to explicitly model skewness and kurtosis. The log TLF is basically a version of the log stable distribution. And I'm going to talk more about that in a minute. And then the final one is a bootstrapping method, which we could base on historical data. Since we have the extreme events in the historical data, why not use those extremes to model asset returns? So here is the log stable distribution, and I'll tell you a little about the application of this distribution. It was first used by Benoit Mandelbrot, who looked at basically a histogram of changes in cotton prices, and he said, that doesn't follow a bell curve, that has fat tails. So he used this fat tail distribution, this so-called stable Parisian distribution, which basically has infinite variance. It just has these very fat tails. And then he had a student at the University of Chicago in the early 1960s whose name was Eugene Fama. You've probably heard of Eugene Fama. He went on later in the 70s to talk about efficient markets. Before he did efficient markets, though, he looked at fat tail distributions. So he took the basic model that Mandelbrot was using to model cotton prices, and he used it on stock returns. And lo and behold, he discovered that returns on stocks, individual stocks, are fat tailed. Now what I've done here is I've applied that very same model that Fama used in his doctorate dissertation to the S&P 500 going back to 1926, and you can see quite a difference with the bell curve, because look how well this log stable, this fat tail distribution, fits the data. It actually starts looking like, meaningful probabilities here. I did the same thing here with global equities. Actually, I used all four approaches here with the global equities. The purple line is the bell curve. Then I have the Johnson distribution, which is wider than the bell curve. And then I have the log TLF, or basically the log stable distribution, which you can see has very fat tails, both left and right. That's important. And then the final one, which I think is the most interesting, is the bootstrap method, where I simply used history to create the curve. And that's got all those funny lumps and bumps in the tails, because whenever there's a point in the data in which there's an extreme event, an outlier, the bootstrap distribution picks that up and models it explicitly. We can also do more interesting modeling of covariation. Basically what happens here is that instead of having, if you do a scatter plot of two returns, you can then draw basically an ellipse that says 95, according to the bell curve model, 95% of the returns should fall in that inner purple ellipse, but you can see there's a lot more, and it only should be 5% of points outside of it. But if we use the fat tail distribution, you can see we're a lot closer to the truth, because we draw a much, much larger ellipse, and it captures more of the actual returns. But alternatively, what we could do is we can use actually every one of those dots in our model. That's what I'm going to talk about a little later. Before I do, however, I'm going to just say a word about what about measuring reward. Remember, mean variance analysis is the original Markowitz method. What is mean? Arithmetic mean, expected return. Basically, it's what? The probability weighted average of all possible returns over the next period of time, which is typically like a year. Does that make sense? Well, what I've done here is I have instead of asset class returns, these three points, A, B, and C, represent the results of doing mean variance analysis on three different roulette wheels. Each wheel has 6 points. And the way it works is that if it lands on you put down, say, $100. If it lands on 2, you double your money. If you land on 1, you break even. If it lands on 3, you triple your money. But if it lands on 0.5, you have your money. Now, so there's an arithmetic mean and a standard deviation associated with each of these roulette wheels. If these were, in fact, portfolios, you might say A is the conservative portfolio, B is the moderate, and C is the aggressive portfolio. However, let's look what's on the wheels. Okay, well, A, you can either have or double your money. That's why it has the average payout of 1.5. C, you can either triple your money or have it. And then B, there's a 1 out of 6 chance you can lose everything. If we were playing game B, no matter how much money was on the table, if it landed on the zero spot, you lose everything, no matter how much you won in the past. So there's a 1 out of 6 chance of losing everything with every spin. There's another game that, there is a game that has that proper, exact property, which is Russian roulette. Okay? Anyone want to play Russian roulette? So one of the ideas, and this was actually one of the ideas Markowitz explored back in 1959. He wrote, he did in his book, he has a whole chapter on this very topic, which is if you're a long-term investor, you know, what should you be maximizing? And it's not the arithmetic mean, it's the geometric mean. How do you calculate a geometric mean? Well, instead of adding these spots and dividing by 6, we multiply them and take the 6th root. And so for A, that gives us 1.41. For C, it gives us 1.22. And for B, of course, anything times 0 is 0, we get 0. So by taking the geometric means rather than the arithmetic means, what we can immediately tell that B is not a game we want to play. Particularly if we want to play it repeatedly, because what the geometric mean represents, it is the growth rate if you play the game over and over and over and over again. So with game B, you know, you might be doing great, tripling your money, your $100 goes to 300, your 300 goes to 900, you know, and then you have $1 million on the table, and then you hit the wheel and it's zero and you're bankrupt. This argues we should be looking, this is the argument that Harry Markowitz basically made in 1959, was maximize the geometric mean rather than the arithmetic mean, and that leads to what is called the Kelly criteria, which is actually used by professional gamblers, so they don't lose their whole portfolio, basically, they don't use all their money. They basically maximize their geometric mean when they gamble. And so as you can see, and this is just showing you the return distributions from playing the game 12 times, that clearly the probability of if there's a 1 out of 6 chance of losing all your money on one spin, if you play the game 12 times, the probability rises to 89%. I don't think you want to play with those odds. And then, you can see the other ones. One of the properties of A is that you can never lose money with A. So, you can see most of it's to the right, and that tells us it's generally a better distribution. Okay, so that's, I want to make those remarks on measuring reward before I go on to the next one, is measuring risk. I mentioned at the beginning that standard deviation has been very much criticized. So the question is, what should we use instead? Well, let me start. There are actually a number of different options way you can measure risk. One of the most popular has become value at risk, which basically describes where the left tail is. It basically says where the left tail is. So if I had a portfolio and I told you that it's 5% value at risk over the next year is 30%, what that would tell you is there was a 1 out of 20 chance, 5% chance, of losing 30% or more over the next year. Now, value at risk has lost a lot of credibility, particularly over the financial crisis, I think for two reasons. One is if I tell you the value at risk is 30%, people think that means you'll never lose more than 30%, or there's only 1 out of 20 chance you'll lose 30%. They forget it's or more, not just 30%, 30% or more. Secondly, a lot of times value at risk in practice, unfortunately, has been measured using bell curve models, which kind of, to me, I think defeats the whole purpose of value at risk. If value at risk is supposed to be a statistic that describes the tail, let's use a fat tail distribution. There is another related measure, which I think is better, which is called conditional value risk. which basically asks the question, if you were to lose the value risk or more than that, on average, how much might you lose? That's the conditional value risk, and we can illustrate the two concepts like this. This is a cumulative distribution curve, and we can see on this chart that both the 5% value risk and the 1% value risk. And what we do with conditional value risk is we average together everything in that tail. And that's why conditional value risk is always greater than value risk. This is important because, as you can see from this chart, we can have different distributions all with the same value risk and very different conditional value risk depending upon how thick the tail is. So the thin tail, a bell curve model, would have a much lower conditional value risk than a fat tail model, even if it had the same value risk. And well, that brings us to Markowitz 2.0. Which is actually the term, I did not invent the term Markowitz 2.0, it was actually invented by my co-author, Sam Savage, at Stanford. But I'm the one giving the lecture today, so I can call Markowitz 2.0. The idea is that we go beyond, the general idea is that there's a good versus, Markowitz's basic insight, there's something good and there's something bad. Return is good, risk is bad. But we don't have to use mean and variance to do that. We can generalize that. And then also we don't have to use something that's limited to mean and variance. We can use any distribution we like. This is just a summary then of the two approaches, the Markowitz 1.0 approach of 1952 versus the Markowitz 2.0 60 years later. And the idea is we're going to use something called scenario analysis to model returns rather than mean and variance. And we can move to a multi, you know, our good doesn't have to be a single period model. It could be the long-term geometric mean or the Kelly criterion. And the risk, instead of standard deviation, we can use any risk measure we like. I'm going to use conditional value risk, but you can use any measure of tail risk, basically. So if you ever used a, or if you ever taught your students how to use a Markowitz optimization program, for each asset class, you come up with an expected return and a standard deviation, and for every pair of asset classes, a correlation coefficient. What you do in scenario analysis is that you come up with scenarios. So here's an example, and then in each scenario, you say what the return would be. So in this example, you would say, four scenarios based on inflation and growth. And of course, with stocks do best in low inflation and high growth environments. They do their worst, typically in high inflation, low growth environments. And we can ask in each of these economic environments, how might each of these asset classes do? Once we've done that, we have this table, and it's very easy to derive directly from this table what are the properties of any asset mix. All we have to do is take the weighted average returns. Now in actual practice, you typically wouldn't use a small table like this, you use a very large table, and often that is done through Monte Carlo simulation to develop the inputs. And then this is just to show you that scenario analysis is very general, and you're not limited, you can use history, but you're not limited to history. You can use Monte Carlo, but you're not limited to Monte Carlo. You could even just make a list of scenarios yourself and come up with what you think might happen. This particular list of scenarios came from an article that was published by the CFA Society of the UK, a professional investor. And it just simply lists the 15 bad scenarios that Towers Watson was thinking about back in June of 2011. You might want to rethink this list. Being located in Europe, I think about number 10 a lot. And I don't put it as number 10, I put it higher than that. So when you're doing Markowitz 2.0, because it's based on scenarios rather than on numbers, we can draw pictures. And for any individual asset class, we can draw a picture of its return distribution, and there are my four asset classes and four fat tail distributions. And then for the co-movement between them, we can draw scatter plots. Instead of doing a matrix of numbers, we can do a matrix of scatter plots. And as you notice on some of these scatter plots, particularly, you know, well, basically on pretty much all of them, you notice in the lower left-hand corner, it's very linear. But in the upper top corner, you notice it's very non-linear. So you know, we can have sort of sometimes linear, sometimes non-linear. We can put into this model, and that's a very helpful thing. If you think about, suppose I want to include scenarios such as a global financial crisis in which all equity markets crash together, I can do this in the scenario approach. And once I've done that, I can now create a what I call a Markowitz 2.0 efficient frontier. Where I can put my good and bad. So here my good is geometric mean, my bad is conditional value risk, and along that efficient frontier, of course, there are various portfolios, but each portfolio can have a very interesting distribution associated with it, depending on the method I use to generate the scenarios. In this example, I used an historical bootstrap method, and thereby I created this distribution, which has these, you know, these kind of very lumpy tails. And that's, I think, part of the most interesting part of the story is that with scenario analysis, you know, and you can start talking to people about what, you know, what risk is. So instead of showing a bell curve, which shows nothing happening in the tails, you can start communicating, you know, the risk of the market. So I do have a book. There's, I think my colleagues are gonna say what's happening to those books. There, but you can certainly order it from Amazon.com. And for those of you that are on the faculty here, I'd appreciate if you would assign the book to your students.
Hi, that was really. This is Orbin Agosh. I'm the program director at SKBI. Actually, that was a very enlightening talk, since I was just coming from my portfolio management class. I used black swans, and a clip from Nassim Taleb's talk about what black swans mean. He talks about internet to be a black swan as well. But anyway, my question was, in this particular case, when you are looking at extreme tail events, it is possible that your scenarios might have also problems with the correlation that is changing over time. So at different scenarios, you could have different correlation structure as well. How do you plan to address that in this situation? Because the efficient frontier will be changing.
Yes, that's a good point. I mean, what I presented today really is a framework for putting this together. I mean, now the hard part is going to be with people like you to figure out how to build these inputs. The only thing I would say is that doing this type of analysis, even if it's not exactly right, is better than doing nothing. And there's an illustration that Sam Savage uses, so I'll use it here, which is when you need a stepladder to reach something high that you can't reach, do you shake the ladder before you get on it? You do? Okay. You know, that's Monte Carlo simulation, by the way, okay, if you're subjecting it. Now, did you also know, I'm sure your physicist colleagues here at the university would tell you know that the forces that you apply to the ladder when you shake it are totally different than the forces when you step on it. Are you still going to shake a ladder? Yeah.
Behavioral bias, yes.
Yeah, right. So the model, the point is that our stochastic model doesn't have to be a perfect stochastic model. We are at least going to be helped by it to understand that there really are these kinds of tail risks, and even if we don't get the list exactly right. Now, one of the things I believe in too is that any sort of modeling should be used in an interactive way. That just because you put the model together, run it through the computer, and you get the output, you're not done. It's best to experiment with the model. So, for example, you might have scenarios in which there's a global market crash. You might ask, what would happen to my asset allocations if I, say, change the probability of that market crash from what whatever, 2%, 5%, or whatever, and kind of experiment with the model. So I think it's a big help, even if it's not perfect.
Just one more question. Yes. There is something called a capital allocation line that we draw when you are finding out what is the best risk-return trade-off.
Yes.
Now, in this particular scenario, your capital allocation line would not be based on the standard, you know, Markowitz 1.0, which is the standard deviation at the bottom and the excess return on top, mm-hmm. but it would be something different. So do you have some sense of what is the best sort of risk-adjusted return, so to say?
Well, risk-adjusted return is a whole nother topic, which I'd have to give another lecture. What I would say, though, about the capital market line is the usefulness of that approach has actually Harry Markowitz and Bill Sharpe still debate. Markowitz, of course, I mean, when Sharpe came up with the idea, as I said, at the beginning of the capital asset pricing model, which says just use cash to go up and down that global portfolio. And Markowitz, Markowitz points out that you can't really do that because you can't really hold stuff, you know, invest short, and you sort of force back to the efficient frontier. The framework that I presented today, it really is along the lines of Markowitz, not along the lines of Sharpe. It's a normative model, not a positive model. It's a model that you would use to help you as to make decisions. It's not a model of markets.
My name is Poon, SMU. At the end of the day, after all your work, you will come up with some weights, hopefully.
Yes.
How would I view those weights, and what kind of comfort level, or what kind of explanation? You know, because you're looking at scenarios, and you're coming up with the weights. Uh-huh. So after choosing the weights, how would I interpret the impact of this scenario and what's going to happen here?
Asset allocation is a combination of art and science. As scientific as we try to make it with quantitative models, at the end of the day, someone still has to make a judgment call. Now, one of the things, ways I think we can use the quantitative model is once you have that scenario model, you have those asset allocation you're looking at, what would happen if I would have changed that asset allocation a bit? Suppose my asset allocation were 60% stocks. What would happen if I went to 65% stocks? What would happen if I went to 55% stocks? The earlier question, I said you can experiment with the probabilities of the scenarios. You can also experiment with the weights of the asset mix and see how sensitive. What you'll generally find is that as long as you're kind of in the right neighborhood, the risk-return trade-off point you'll get to is not going to be that different by adjusting the asset mix a little bit. So that becomes then more of the art. But the science part is basically experimentation.
I'm Carlton from GIC. I guess the question about input estimation, because I think one of the advantages of the Markowitz model is effectively it's relatively parsimonious. There are not that many inputs to the optimization, whereas going down this route where you actually have scatter plots for each pair of asset classes, ultimately then you have a lot of inputs to estimate. Also scatter can be very different, the probability of the series can be very different, and a lot of things to estimate.
Okay, well, first let me go back to the question is, the scenario approach is fundamentally non-parametric. If I had 5 asset classes and 1,000 scenarios, I'd have to have 5,000 data points.
Yep.
Okay. Now, is parsimony really that helpful? I don't think it is. I think, first of all, because you can always use a parametric approach to base your Monte Carlo on.
Sure.
Secondly, with the flexibility of the scenario approach, you can also look at the data in an unconstrained way. So I don't simply have to say this was the standard deviation of U.S. stocks. I can ask, you know, U.S. stocks had these fat tails in it. So the chart I showed you, with 1,000 scenarios and 4 asset classes, that was all based upon 4,000 points but I generated those 4,000 points with a Monte Carlo simulation.
Bootstrap.
Well, you can bootstrap or you can just do parametric Monte Carlo.
Thank you.
So all the cars are supposed to be equally probable in this experiment. Right? Okay. So if you can read the name of the winner, please.
And while the football session is on, let me also announce that Dr. Kaplan will also be donating an autographed copy of the same book to the SMU library, and Prof. Yu will receive this on behalf of the library. Thank you on behalf of SMU.
First of all, I should say the contribution is being made by Morningstar.
And to express our thanks to Dr. Kaplan for coming to Singapore and our campus, Prof. Yu will present a token of appreciation to Dr. Kaplan.
Thank you.